Alrighty. So, welcome to our little series, Bread and Go Stuff. It's a little series I like to call Go Component Lab, which is basically me working on Go stuff, mostly components. Today's actually an interesting example of a project that is bringing together some of the stuff that we did before. So we worked on this sort of hub aggregator thing for an RPC system. And then we also, some time ago, started doing the sidecar supervisor. And so today we're gonna use that sidecar supervisor and this hub to build this sort of like pluggable RPC daemon. Yeah, we'll get into that. I've been starting to create events for schedules, or on the schedule ahead of time for future stuff. So if you go to my stream and go to events, you can see individual streams next week. Basically, the RPC system that I have has kind of been a prototype, and so I kind of want to build the stack that I know that I want now, which is not necessarily over quick, but it's over a multi-stream, a multiplex stream abstraction. Quick is just another multiplex stream, and it's interesting, so there's a library I wanted to try to see how that goes. So I was gonna try rebuilding it using Quick, and then later next week I'm gonna do an abstraction for different multiplex stream protocols, and then, you know, it'll probably be a very similar API, and then we can move the RPC systems, and this RPC can work across any of those protocols. And then by next week, I'll kind of fill out the next week. But if you want, you can schedule those. It's always 5 o'clock Central Time on Tuesdays and Thursdays. So feel free to chat. Looks like chat's working. So let's get started. Sweet. Let's see. We have the supervisor here, I guess. I'll be importing duplex, so I kind of want both projects open. Let's call this. This itself is a prototype for the foundation for another project, so you'll just have to kind of wait and see what that's all about. We'll just call this RPC daemon. I've been using this Twitch profile command that we made. So it's made it much easier to switch the metadata for this Twitch stream using this. So that's very cool. I've also been using this export thing, which I might have mentioned before, which is it kind of manually exports Twitch stuff to YouTube. But and then eventually they'll all be automated together in a single process, but we're not there yet. And that actually gets at what the point of this pluggable RPC thing is. So a lot of automation stuff. So what's next? I wanted to, we could set this up. Part of it is being a hub. So why don't we start This code, by the way, is on my prototypes repository. Nobody's really asked for... Let's see, I will want to get rid of that data directory. YouTube export. That is the Chrome data so that I can log into Twitch so it doesn't have to log in every time, which I guess I just deleted, so I'm gonna have to log into it before I can use it again, but I figured I should actually might want to delete some commits in here. So anyway, if you want me to push this code, let me know. I don't really have a reason to push it yet, other than my own backups, but if you wanted to follow along, let me know in a comment or something like that. All right, so RPC daemon. Let's kind of define what we're going to be doing here. We're creating a daemon supervisor that runs a directory of plugins. Which is kind of the example that we did with the supervisor. One of the things that it will do that the supervisor doesn't, though, is provide a hook for plugin changes. And so we can use that for rebuilding Go code. So normally it'll reload binaries, and so here we can write a Go file, and then as that changes, it can rebuild that Go file in the hook. And then run the hub that we made. So we actually might want to just go grab that and start with that and then start working in the supervisor part. But then we also want to have some examples here to work with. I guess we'll call them plugins. Maybe we'll call them modules, because it doesn't really do anything else. So it's more of like a plugins to what? It does nothing. We'll call them modules. It's where the actual functionality is. So we need to go grab some other code. I'm not sure. Okay, code will open another editor window. So here's our hub. We have not generalized that because we're rewriting a bunch of stuff anyway. So right now we're kind of doing copy and paste prototyping with stuff that works. And then as we start to kind of build the more formalized components like supervisors, sort of, you know, well tested and stuff like that, although it's probably still not ready for being a release, but we can at least use it. So if you were here for any of these, you probably remember. Some of this. Create a WebSocket server where you can register methods. We do our own sort of message routing and kind of a NAT address ID translation for messages. So this is our hub, and I'm not gonna. Let's see. It would be nice, actually, to create let's do that. So let's actually create a little Python duplex RPC server as a module and connect to it and test it, and then we'll adapt it to connect to the hub. And then we'll add the sidecar supervision stuff, so the daemon will then run the Python script. Let's see, which Python is this to? User local bin Python 3. Let's run that. Should be able to just do this, right? Hello world. Cool. So now let's go grab let's see if we have a simple Python. This is actually a little demo server. Let's see. We'll get rid of this one. So basically, it's just a little echo. Oh, interesting. I made it a manual thing in this library. That makes sense. Alright, which pip 3? Yeah, pip 3. I forget, do we say install? And the package name is different, isn't it? It's like WebSocket for Pi or something, I don't know. Let's see if this helped though. In theory, it's running. Let's also look at a client. We were testing with a client somewhere in here. Let's see, Golang client. And we could actually make this, it actually is kind of generic. I'm thinking we could make the second argument some JSON, and then we basically parse that and send that off as the argument. So let's also do. And let's see, we want to unmarshal some. Convert to a bunch of bytes flag arg 1, although I think we can say if params is empty, then params can be say null. I think this is what I want to do here. Point to a request. That didn't work. And then also because of this typify workaround, we had to do this. All right. So this is sort of a generic client. We can actually test it with this echo server that we made here. So we'll have to run. Server, go run server. And then we can try this client. is echo. Alright, so we got nil back. Let's see if we can do some JSON objects. So foo bar. Okay. So we've got this sort of generic client. Now let's try and use that with our Python version of this echo server. So this one is running on 8001. I'll change this to go run client echo. Guess null. Right, so looks like we have some bugs in our Python implementation. It might just be that it doesn't handle null values, so let's try doing this again. I don't know if we need to restart this, but okay, so from the client perspective, it actually worked, it echoed, and we can actually get rid of some of that. Somewhere in duplex, we're doing a printing this. I think we were doing some debugging there. And we should also, it's gonna be a little bit harder because we would need to publish the package because I think it's not linked to this one. So it might be simpler if, no, I guess we can't force it to do that, huh? Let's see, what is our message? Payload, omit empty. I guess we can get rid of that, and that should fix the null problem for now. Let's see though what's going on here. Zero bytes read on a total of 2 expected bytes. Above exception was direct cause of the following. Absorption is closed. Let's see, our hub examples, we actually added a close that does the right thing. So let's, I think we don't have that here. So let's try running this whole example again. First with hello world, it worked. It still doesn't like that we're closing for some reason. It could just be an implementation that I should check for the exception connection closed. because I don't see any problem with this. Then we can try it with a null value. And that worked as well. So we just have to ignore this error until I could update the Python package and then link it or whatever, but I'm just gonna rewrite all this stuff anyway. So I think I can put up with this. Interesting. Actually, this will go away once we turn this into a client that connects to the hub, so. And I think we're at that point because we can run the hub. We just need to turn this from a server into a client. So I'm trying to remember if I have a client example in Python. I know I made, let's see, a shell async. I made a, let's see, what, where did I make that? I think Fluxbot. And which actually we're using the WS4Py version of this, so it runs it in a thread. So let's why don't we actually reconnect was just like a helper. Why don't we actually make a separate client, make sure this works with the server, and then we'll echo with a Python true. And we can wait on it, why not? I forget if that's, I think that's on by default. And we know that it's listening on 8001. So, run the server. Now we'll run the client. I guess we don't aren't doing anything with the response. Let's see, can we print it or something like that? Okay. So it worked, it echoed. It's printing the value that it returned. And it's actually not hanging up, so we haven't seen the error over here. But as soon as we do that, we should see there. So this client works. That's pretty nice. We can actually start taking this code and putting it in here. So. Async IO. I've not done this though. Well, maybe I can change this client to also use async IO because Otherwise, this is going to get really complicated. Or at least it'll be single threaded. Let's actually just try it though. So we won't need any of this. But we do this. I guess because threads, we would do this. Async false. And then lastly, I think we want to do peer route. I actually don't remember. So, we also want to do, we actually do want to do a call. Which is, so we're doing outbound. This should work. We want to register. Echo. So now we need to run our RPC daemon hub. We could run that one, but we will run this one, one of these. Okay, connecting 8,000. Demo. All right, I think it registered. So oh, you know it would be nice if I did this. I don't know what that's going to look like, but make sure everything's clean. So now somewhere we had a client. Demo client. So the only, so we have our hub running, listening on 8,000. We have this demo thing running that provides an echo method connected to 8000, and then we're gonna do a client that tries to do a call to the hub. And see if it gets to this thing and comes back. That's true. This is JSON, not Python. Okay. So that works. It's cool when your three-year-old code works pretty okay across languages. All right, so we don't really need this anymore. And I guess we can create something else that runs. And then the idea is we can use a client and run both of those methods and they'll go to different services. So I think we have Node. Sure. So we'll do the same thing now with Node, where we'll make a server, connect to it directly, then change it back, change it into a client that connects to the hub. We can rename this to PyDemo. So let's get back to our duplex project, JavaScript. Let's use this as a server. We'll try to run it with global packages here. Hopefully, let's see, I don't care about this. Do I care about that? No, I don't care about that. What a convoluted example. What was I thinking? Can you do multiple? I won't risk it. This probably won't even show anything useful. Okay, perfect. I don't even know why we need a server object, so we'll just do that. Oops. And let's see that this runs. So we can do npm install g Node.js WebSocket. Oh, come on. Do I really want a node module directory? God damn. Okay. Okay, it doesn't have duplex. That's fine. I think I can actually do the linking stuff, right? So that's source, GitHub, program, duplex, JavaScript. This. I think. Package.json, yep. Is that cool? I guess so. Ah, no, it doesn't like that. Duplex.js? The fuck is this shit? Alright, so now we can try our client again. Echo hub false, because we want a node. Connection refused. Oh, it's going to the wrong one. Didn't like that. So, first of all, it didn't seem to get, didn't seem to get our object. Oh, I think this is a we're supposed to do an error. That was one of the things I changed. So let's try doing this again. Ah, there, it worked. So I'm guessing it's also picky about the connection not being closed. Well, I guess we're closing it correctly, right? Because we're using that client. And we do close, right? So but again, I think this will go away once we make this a client. So that is the next step. The idea is we can, let's see, do we have an example of a client in here? Again, I guess we made one over, I made one over here. Oh, bullshit. Alright, we gotta look in here. So, instead of creating a server, I'll keep that stuff around. This is 8,000. This would just be endpoint, but we can just hard code it. I don't care. Skip ahead to rush chat. I don't know if this keep alive is necessary in our case. So at this point, oh, I see, this is all supposed to be indented as well. So at this point, we're ready to go. We have a peer, so we can, for example, be able to just call. Method args callback. We're calling register args. So let's make a different thing that's not echo, but do an uppercase thing. Assuming it's a string, don't JavaScript strings have an uppercase? Two uppercase? Registering upper. And we actually don't care about the response. I suppose if there's an error, but. All right, fine. Or is it, would it be, undefined? No, it would be null, right? I don't know. And it should actually just sit there, and so that would be fine because it will. Do we need to? Let's see, does this handshake should actually start routing messages, I think. Well, I guess because it's event-based, so. We can try this. All right, so we'll run our, what are we gonna run? The hub. Here we'll run JavaScript thing. Presumably it's connected. So we would be able to uppercase. Now we want to go back to 8,000. Some strings. Oh, because it's supposed to be JSON. All right, so we got an uppercase thing that worked. And if we were to create a new, actually run our Pi one as well, we should be able to run either of those. We can do echo or upper. So let's try echo. So we got our echo. And if we do upper, then we get our upper. So at a high level, we are, I mean, in theory, we already got all the pieces for this working before. We just hadn't actually done an example where we had like two different languages connect up to the hub before. When we got the hub working, we did it with just Go. But now we have Python and JavaScript connecting to it, and then using our Go client and running methods. So now the idea is, because we have to, so you can kind of see where that sidecar supervisor is helpful in that these methods that we're running method providers that we're running we have to run manually. So the idea is the RPC daemon should run them, and so that's where we'll use our supervisor. So we'll close all of this up. And we'll kind of look at our example here. We want to run something like this. Where's our main? So we're serving that, and that's good. We should actually do that first. Let's see here. We could just do that for now. We do all this. We don't take any argument. I guess that's why we needed a flag parse. So now we can give it the directory, which would just be modules. I mean, if we run it in the same directory, I guess we could hard code modules in there. Cool. So, let's see what this does. Go run RPC daemon. Started JavaScript. I don't see the Python one. That's very curious, isn't it? We can run our client and see the upper works. But does Echo work? Echo does work. Well, I mean, this seems like kind of a bug in our supervisor. We're not seeing the output of one of our processes. Yeah, and the Python one. Well. All right, so now we can kind of pretend that we didn't write this, so how would we debug this? We've got our supervisor, load directory. We can try and... So what we don't have is any way to just list all the processes that it's managing. So, let's see, we could do get all. And it returns a map? String to process? So I guess there would be no errors, right? So what we can do now is have this basically print out all. Let's see what it says. Says it's running PyDemo. Just not getting any of the output. I wonder why. If we were to go into modules. Let's say we wanted to, like, we were like piping into it or something. Like maybe it needs like a shell or something. I remember the Python interpreter being weird about this. Like if we were to do something like this, it still shows stuff. Oh, I was thinking of buffering. Sometimes it'll buffer. Okay. So that's interesting. We can see that there's processes. Process for, what was it? It's a big ass path. Did it just take us to that file? Oh, VS Code. God damn it, I didn't want that either. Give me this. Copy. S logs. String it up. We might need to do that after it runs a little bit, but nothing in its logs. Oh, but again, it might not have run yet, so let's try running this after a little while. Still nothing. Very curious. Do you think this is going to standard error? In an output file. Okay, so it goes to standard out. Flush false. Whether the output is buffered is usually determined by file. So this is that buffering nonsense that Python does. I think even if this is true, well, maybe this is what overrides it. Let's check it out. Flush. Oh, look at that. Our thing's kind of working. It's interesting that it's not exiting non-zero. It did that as a single write. Goddamn Python. It's buffering. I think there's an interpreter flag for doing unbuffered. Yeah. This is a weird thing. I don't know why Python still does this, but... So it's doing this because we're outputting the logs, right. So that's why we're seeing it twice. So I think the flush thing worked, but by doing this argument, we actually get it. This is interesting. It was designed to show us the output when it crashes, and we got that. So now we don't care about this. It is working fine. Why is this? If you want to. Okay, so. Again, we can use this. Echo. And so now, in theory, we can actually change these files. Like, I can say echo with two colons, right? And now we have a bug. Oh, that's the Go server. It's saying it's getting an unexpected close. So, what do you think is happening here? All right, so let's look at what happens when a file changes, right? Let's see if we can read the code and figure this out. So, I believe it's a write event, so we're just doing a reload here. Reload, it is reloadable, so then we go and reload it. Try and kill the existing process. We start the process. So we wait for it to be exited. So in theory, this will run when this is run. Thank you. So I'm guessing what's happening is the first time we start, we get a reload here, which sets up this go routine. Then the next time we try and reload, right, we kill that process. And not only does that, is it then going to start a process, but it's also going to, the previous one is going to reload as well. So basically, we have to, if we, I mean, one idea is to send a some kind of reload channel signal, and then wait for that here as well. And if we get that reload, then we don't do any of this, I guess. Mm-hmm. So I just wanna double check. I mean, I think that's what's happening, but I also wanna see some stuff. Let me how did we specify restart delay? I think that was just something that we do in tests. That's interesting. There's no way to configure any of this outside of tests. That's good to know. Let's make this 1 second. Because, no, let's make it 2 seconds. I suspect, yeah, this will be interesting. So it looks like it's doing what it's supposed to, which is every 2 seconds, I mean, what we theorized. I should try and write a test for this. This is more of a regression test. Because once we fix it, it's kind of a weird test to see, like, oh, if you, if you load it up and then do a reload, does it reload more than once? case I forget. Reloading. Kills. So it starts a new process and old process exits and reloads. So like I said, we could do a fix that exited, reloaded. If it's reloaded, we don't do any of this stuff. Which means we don't see the logs if our reload caused the old one to crash. But I think that's... document that logs will be dumped if reload causes non-zero exit or something, right? Or redesign it or whatever. The fuck does this want? I just had to install it. Defer. Ooh, I don't know about this too. No. Yeah, I know that makes sense. Apparently status is localized. So here we would do reloaded. I guess we have nothing to transfer, so we might as well make it a Boolean channel. I was gonna say we could get the exit code, but the only way we could do that is if we actually let it finish the thing. So I guess we could set true and then after the exit, I don't know. We can always come back to that. All right, so now reload is sending that signal. I mean, honestly, we could just also close it, but all right, let's see what this does. So now if I edit this, we get one restart. So I think that was the problem. See? So we are able to just save this file and immediately use the new method because this daemon manager is managing a daemon process of this script. And so that's kind of the whole point of this RPC daemon. It allows for this kind of real-time modification of these plugins or modules. So now we also talked about a hook. All right, so we know we have to make a hook. And I guess I'm not sure if we had a way to do this in our supervisor test. Let's see, supervisor thing. Let's see, watch. So, I guess my idea is we could call watch and pass it a delegate, you know, some kind of object that has some methods, which is kind of a less go way because we're already kind of just wrapping events. Let's see. But we want to do it like so I think this actually will try and reload any file that changes in the directory, and only after it goes to reload does it check to see if it's reloadable. So for example, a Go script, a Go file would not be reloadable. So the hook that we're looking for is when a file changes that I guess was not reloadable. We locked to do a file system thing. Do we need to do that? I don't think so, right? Yeah, so anyway, so in theory, we could actually just check reloadable before these, and then call. You know, we could do maybe like an observer or. Let's supervisor. Yeah, this is interesting. I'm tempted to do something that I actually don't see in Go that often, which is to say, which is to do a callback, like on non-reloadable. Say, I want something. That is for. Do this on change. It's a function that does a the path boolean if it's reloadable, and boolean if it's been deleted. Oh, I got my. I'm back and forth between C sharp and Go. Let's see on change. So then we just do. Not nil. Call on change. Here is the event name. Reloadable. We have to call reloadable. Ugh. Okay. We need to make a little helper function. Because we will write this, you know, a few times, so. Is it deleted? No, because this is that. So this are, these are the same. This is true. Okay, so I guess we can try using that now, which apparently we can just set on change. I even grab the function signature. And I'll do a log. Path reloadable deleted. So if I change this file, I mean, if is it reloadable? True. Okay, so if I were to edit a file that is not something that'll reload, log file version requires. Foobar true. Then I get it false. So now, for example, we could have a Go script in there. New file. GoDemo.go. I guess because it's based on the path name and I wasn't removing extensions, that I don't actually need to name these with a prefix. They can all just be demo, whatever, but let me just. So let's, I guess we'll rename those. See how it's reloading them. Just disable it. So now the idea is that I could provide a hook that would run a script on some of these changes. So this is more of a feature of RPC daemon than the supervisor. Like the supervisor, we did the on-change hook. Which I'm not sure how I feel. What is idiomatic with Go in terms of callbacks? It's usually not to say on, but it's more like change callback. Maybe I answered my question, is that's what I would call it. So. Let's see. I could probably remove this if I were to make reloadable just return true or false, but I think reloadable does potentially return an error, but really just that it can't stat the file. And if it can't stat a file, it is not reloadable. So, but that tells you, for whatever reason, that doesn't tell you the problem if you're to debugging it or whatever. So, Does it just end? How about that? So now we'll just, if not deleted, trigger hook. What the fuck? Why would I do that? So if we change something, if we change this, we change go, it doesn't matter. But if we create a hook, change that's just like and bash echo hello, we have no way to see the output, but we can at least see that it doesn't run because we didn't set the permissions on it, so. So in theory it ran. Let's see, what is some way to OSX command line notification. See, oh, I guess because I have do not disturb on. So it shows up. Oh shit. Oh, I'm not out of. Alright, so you don't see that, but I do. On RPC daemon, and we'll say, well, changed. So we'll just use that here, and look at our go file, modify it. I get a notification. So, we can now use this hook to build this Go file and basically load it. So, let's try doing that. I'm not sure what. We're probably in whatever the current working directory is. So, oh, one good thing would be to see what the path is that we're given. Escape. right, so I get the path. I guess the simplest thing is to see. Let's see, how to bash like ends with. Check if a string begins or ends with some value. Yeah. So this would be like. File dot py equals star dot go false, but if it's go, then it's true. So if the argument one equals star dot go. So now I should only see it if I modify a go file. So if I change this to false, I don't see anything. But if I change this, I see a notification. Okay, so I want to build this thing. I don't know what directory I'm in, though. Okay, I mean not RPC daemon. Go build modules. Shit, I need the base name. Oh, all right, there's a command. I forget where we are. You don't have to. Let's see it. Oops. Without go. Oh, it's giving me the full path. Oh, because I need to do both. Can I do? Can I do this? Exit status 1. All right, it does not like that. Ah! I saw nothing. Did I not get some part of that? That should actually... Maybe it doesn't like the quotes. Nope, still nothing. All right, well, doesn't base name. actually. If it is causing it to spin out. We can, No, that's... That's fine, like, that was the point of select. I thought you could... Why is it doing that? I guess if it's not doing anything else, it assumes that's bad. Well, that doesn't seem to be true. This is probably what we want to do. So after the first time, it doesn't seem to reload. Well, it doesn't seem to trigger the thing, so let's see what's going on here. All right. So it does not like the case RPC daemon possibly halts when reloading a program that exits. But otherwise, this is working. If we did a go, hell, why don't we do that for the fun of it? A little over time, but let's see, we've got a server here that serves up hello. Now we need a hub backend. That's what we want. What a boring back end. This will have to go somewhere else. All right, this now echo, we'll call it echo 2, just because. Flag parse. I'm just gonna say. Oh, it looks like it was making a bunch of them. Whatever. Okay. Oh, what's your problem now? All right, let's just get the output. Where is it? Where are you? Your standard out is my standard error. Same with your standard error. That's now my standard error. Undefined V. That's great. I guess because, yeah. Look, we'll do this. Ah, so that's routing. We should actually, this should work now. We can get our client, we can call echo, and we can call our go one, echo two. Demo is all that output is to standard error though. Why is that? Because I, you know, we said make the our change script output go to standard error, but in this case, it's being picked up from the process as standard error, and so that's very weird that these logs are doing that. Let me actually, if we change this to format, maybe that's different. Because maybe logs are always standard error. That's could be right. Yeah. For some reason, logs go to standard error. That kind of is what I expect, but I don't know. Not entirely. So anyway, there we go. We have three services, and we can edit these in real time, and they will update, so we can continue to hit the RPC daemon. They're all exporting their methods to this hub daemon, and that was a goal for today. So, we did it. Congrats, everybody involved. So we did it. Next week, this RPC system that sort of just kind of magically worked for the most part for us, I'm going to rewrite, like I said in the beginning. So I can finally take care of that. And we'll play with Quick, so that's fun. Rusty, what are you doing? I actually have no idea when that was. Oh, it was just now. Okay. Because I wasn't paying attention. So... that's it. If you're watching on YouTube, let me know if you have comments on how to improve these streams. Or any thoughts at all. Let me know. See you next week.